when you exercise leadership, you will discover that you can't do what you want to do, what you plan to do on your own. You can't. It doesn't matter how smart, how intelligent, how experienced you are. It does not matter how powerful. You need people around you, because without people, you can't do it. Now, because people are so important in you fulfilling the purpose of the leadership that you're exercising, you must keep them. There are a number of guidelines that you can follow to make sure that you keep the loyalty of your people. First and foremost, you have to respect them. People will not be loyal to a person who does not respect them. You have to respect them as human beings. Number one, respect their dignity, respect their pride, respect their history, respect who they are, regardless who they are. If they are your people, you respect them. Color, race, religion, education, economic background, short, tall, fat, thin, it doesn't matter. If they are your people, every single one of them has to feel respected, genuinely respected, for who they are as individuals. And also because who they are as members of your team. So it's double respect as human beings, but special closeness, special kind of team intimacy, because they belong to your team or they're part of the team. That special bond that links people together in an amazing way. And the bond is so strong that even under pressure, in fact, under pressure, it's not that it breaks, it becomes even stronger. Teams save each other's life because of that bond. The key is that you respect them. The second thing that you should do is that you should involve and engage them. They are different but linked. You involve them by asking their opinion. Imagine a tank commander, although he has the power of the authority to dictate his orders. Imagine he's giving instructions to his people in dangerous situations that could mean life or death without even asking their opinions sometimes. Imagine the distance that that would create when you don't even recognize that people around you have at least a minimum level of experience that you could use to get their counsel. So what you do is that you involve them by asking their opinion. And when you do that, you listen, and you listen, and you pay attention so that they feel that they matter. Now, it doesn't mean that you have to follow what they say. In the end, if you're in a position of authority, it's your call. In the end, if it's a leadership intervention, that's your design, you go with what you think is right. But they have to feel that you care about their opinion, even if you don't end up accepting it, or even if you make your own judgment. Now, you also engage them, not just involve them, by delegating the responsibilities or part of the responsibilities to them. So they have to be part of the game. Whatever is happening, whatever is the intervention, whatever is the project, that project involves many parts. They have to be part of this project that you're doing. I have seen many times in the leadership programs that I conduct through different kinds of simulations that people who are not involved, they stop caring. I have seen people who are exercising leadership, they got so focused on the job, so focused on doing what has to be done, that they ignore their people, or at least they involve one or two, and the rest are ignored, not because the people who are exercising leadership don't care, but because they got so involved in the task itself that they forgot to care about the people around them. So slowly and gradually, these people feel rejected, feel that they don't really belong. And they start going further and further, and then after some time, they feel that they're not part of the team. And when the team gets into trouble, some of them, they don't even come to help. Why? Because they were not involved and engaged. Now, sometimes it doesn't really matter the level of involvement you get them in. It doesn't really matter. I mean, you have to decide this based on their competence and based on the requirement of the task. But the point is, they have to feel that they are part of what's happening. Otherwise, it's not them. Why do you expect them to sacrifice? Why do you expect them to stay with you during the entire journey, especially in difficult times, if they're not even feeling that they're part, they're not even feeling useful or needed? So if you don't have something for them to do, create something for them to do. Of course, it has to be meaningful. The point is, they have to be involved and engaged. You have to gain their trust on two levels, on the values level and on the competence level. And what does trust mean? I'll talk a little bit about trust. The core of trust is predictability. So when I trust you, it means I can predict that your behavior, your future behavior, will be in line with my expectations. So trusting you, when they trust you, when you want to gain their trust at the value level, means that you have to display values, ethics, a list of priority, things that you care about. For them, it would be something that they care about also. It would be something that relate to them. They have to know that they can safely predict your next behavior because they know what you're made of as a human being. And that's core for continued loyalty. The other thing that they have to trust you with is your competence. I bet you know people who have worked for bosses whom they do not expect on a competence level. It's the worst that can happen. When you feel that you know more than your boss, or when you feel that your boss doesn't know enough. Just imagine a situation where, you know, a team does not have enough respect or does not trust the judgment and the competence, the professional, technical competence of their, you know, of their leader. That team will die, and of course you can forget about loyalty, and the entire project that the team is involved in will also not work. So be careful that you always make sure that you have gained and maintained and kept and even grown their trust on who you are as a person and on what you represent on a competence level in the job that you're doing. The other point is that you have to trust them. You have to do gestures where they feel that you are trusting them. Sometimes even at the risk of exposing yourself. Like you sleep, in the case of the army, let's say the military case, you sleep and asking them to become the guard. So you use gestures to show them that you trust them. I'll give an example. You're a captain of an airplane, and you tell your co-pilot, please take over. What does that mean? You mean you trust the person. There are so many gestures that you can do to send that message. The gestures that are more powerful are the gestures that show that you're risking yourself or part of yourself because you put yourself in their hands. That feeling of trust that you display to them is a capital that you can invest in the relationship that will translate eventually into more loyalty. Because the core of trust is that you respect them. The core of the trust is that you include them. The core of the trust is that you value their competence. People will not be loyal to somebody who doesn't inspire them. Especially when we talk about, you know, difficult jobs, challenging jobs, a task or a leadership where the context is really serious. It's a serious situation. You have to be a person that they want to be in the future. When they are alone and you're not there, they have to say to tell stories about you. They have to tell their kids and their spouses and partners that one day they would like to become like you. You have to become a symbol of what matters to them. That's why inspiration is so important. By the way, the word inspiration comes from the word inspire. And inspire comes from the word in spirit. It's a complex word. In spirit means, spirit means core. So to inspire somebody means to touch them in their core, to touch their spirit, to touch their core. So you have to touch their core by being who you are. Of course, I'm talking here about exceptional loyalty. I'm talking here about a loyalty in a group that can undertake amazing and significant and great acts of leadership that will translate into brilliant and exceptional result. I'm not talking about casual, shallow relationships. I'm talking about a team, a group of people that are so close together as a team, that are so loyal to each other, under certain loyalty, that when they work together, they can create miracles. That's the level of loyalty I'm talking about. I'm not talking about politics and politeness and etiquette and superficial stuff. I'm talking about serious stuff. They have to feel that the success that you're enjoying, the success that is being made, is also their success. And great leaders understand that. In fact, great leaders use reward as a currency for loyalty. Not just on a technical level, because as a deep reflection of who they are, they know that this could not have happened without them. So every success that happens is immediately related to them. Immediately related to them. I know somebody, I'll just share a small story with you. Somebody in an NGO context, in a charity organization, this person, she's an amazing leader. She was given by one of her supporters a check of $5 million. $5 million. Look what she did. She took the check in this hand, she moved it to the second hand, and she gave it to the team. The man was shocked. I said, I give this to you? He said, no. So then, 2 seconds, like this. $5 million. Now imagine the message in that. Imagine the loyalty that this creates. They have to feel that whatever success is happening is their success, and they have to feel it in every possible way. And a leader, when you're exercising leadership, if you can make your people feel that success will be their success, because failure also will be their failure. You're going to make them pay for the failure anyway. They are part of the whole thing. So when you fail, they will fail with you. So when they feel that they also succeed with you, then loyalty goes to a different level. Take care of them. Take care of them as a human being. Take care of them in terms of their human concerns. Let them feel that you care about them, about their families, about their kids if they have kids, about their interest, about their health. They have to feel that they are taken care of. They have to feel that the relationship is beyond what they mean to you on a professional level, on a technical level, beyond what they mean to you just because they are part of their team. They have to feel that they can depend on you. They have to feel that you're the person that they want to go to when they're in trouble. When you ask them, how are you doing, they have to feel that it's coming from your heart. And you can't fake that. So if you do these things, and if you're authentic, and if you're loyal, if you give them whatever you're expecting from them, you give it in advance, then you have a formidable team. And it is that kind of team that can make miracles.